Well, good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you. If you'll stand to your feet, we'll get started with we're going to actually go to the Lord in prayer first, and then we'll jump into music, okay? God, you're so amazing. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come before you. Father, we thank you for being so good to us. Father, truly, you're absolutely amazing. Your love endures forever. Father, you give grace upon grace. And Lord, we thank you. Lord, I pray right now for Andrea, Lord, and her recovery. Just continue to bless her, Lord. Father, I know there's others among the church family that's been struggling with health issues. We ask, Father, you to touch each one. Lord, we ask for your will to be done. We ask for your blessings, Lord. Father, Lord, as we sing and play and raise our voices to you in song, Lord, truly let our hearts and mind be a heart of mind of worship. And we ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
You know, I'm struggling right now. I'm struggling in a real way. But the day I walked and received Christ as Lord and Savior, this was the altar call. This was the song they sang. Leaning on the everlasting arms. What a fellowship. What a joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness. What a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms. You know, as Christians, we get peace. Not hell, heaven. We get forgiveness when we ask for it. Because of faith in Jesus. And that's wonderful peace.
Jesus Christ. This morning in Sunday school, my dad mentioned how in order to share Christ, we have to know Christ. And we may know the Bible back and forth, but that doesn't always mean that we know and have a personal relationship with Christ. So in order for us to really, really share God with someone, we have to know God.
Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His glory.
6:9. Remember the things I have done in the past, for I am God. I am God. There is none like me. To think that God is God alone, and to think that we get to have a personal relationship with him is so cool. And he wants to have that relationship with us.
I'm going to ask you to stay on our very last song, You Are God Alone.
Sick and all the people who are injured, and just be with them, Lord. We thank you for this blessed morning, even if some of us are just a bit tired. I pray that you will just help us get through this day and let us listen and understand what Mr. John's about to preach, and just help us to listen and want to learn more about you and get closer to you, Lord. And I just pray for everyone on the way home today. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, you may be seated. Dismiss our kiddos. Let's go through a couple of quick announcements. A big thank you for everyone who's already helped out by giving food and helping out with the Locke family. We do have 2 weeks filled right now. So once these 2 weeks is out, we'll come back and reach out to you. So please don't get offended if you said, hey, I can help, but no one's contacted you yet. They've had several folks help outside of our church, which is so cool. But I tell you, Miss Andrea and I talked this week, and she said, you know, I can't imagine what people would go through if they didn't have a church family. She said people have visited, people have called. So thank you so much for doing that. She had a great birthday. She had several guests on her birthday, so thank the Lord for that. Hey, just FYI, those of you who write checks for your tithing, it won't go in the bank tomorrow. It will be delayed 1 week. Just FYI, this doesn't happen very often, but if your check isn't posted immediately, don't stress. It'll be there the next week, okay? It will go through your account next week. Count work schedule. So this is very important. If you have some time, and you may say, well, John, I'm not an electrician. I'm not a plumber. Listen, there's all kinds of stuff that we can do. If you can bend over and pick up limbs and take them and put them in the back of a truck and we'll drive them to the dumps area, we need help, okay? For us to have camp like we normally do, which we're really gunning to do so, we need help. So we have lots of dates there. Now, I know some of this is during the week. Some are on Saturdays. Please find some spots that you can fill in and help out. This week, particularly for me, most of you guys know my back's been giving me some issues, so I'm not lifting anything. But I drove 170 miles thirsty just for camp stuff. I picked up four workers in Mariana. I drove them back. I had to do a water sampling, drove out to Graceville, drove back to camp. I picked up lunch for everybody. I could do some of these things. These are things, if you could help, just stuff like that, we need help. The great thing is Chrome is a ministry in Mariana, and they have been blessing us with several guys who do demo. And so there's a lot of things that have been demoed in the new boys' dorm. Okay, it's a parsonage. We're now demoed, becoming a boys' dorm. So, but we need it done before camp, right, students, right, campers? Because you want to go to camp this year, okay? So we need some help. So if you can, there's lots of dates. I'm not going to read them all. Find one you think you can volunteer. Dwayne Littlefield, here's our pastor in Malone. He is the project manager. He's kind of overseeing everything. I promise you, if you can just go, I'm going to tell you, the work days for the Howells for the last 6.5 years, this is what the Howells usually do. Pick up sticks to put to the burn pile. That is usually what the Howells have done. So if you can do that, we got that needs to be done, okay? Lawn, you know, weed eating, there's some things that need to be done. Sweeping, cleaning up, there's something that everyone can do. So if you can find a time that you can come and help, that'll be awesome. State meeting, we have pamphlets on the front up here, Overcoming Depression. That's going to be our theme for this year. It's our 80th year for the state meeting. What an exciting time to be part of that. So if you'd like to be a part of that, please get the information down there that's available. Also, if you are interested in doing a youth CTS competition, please. I had at least one or two families say they were interested. We're going to have to get a little bit nailed down exactly what they're going to do and get that registered. I don't have an exact date yet, but I know it's coming soon. So any other announcements? All right. This time, our children's church, that's our first through sixth graders, and junior children's church, our preschoolers, head back to the back. You guys are going to work together today, is my understanding. Okay? Awesome. For those who missed Brother Neil last week, you miss a blessing. I got the opportunity. One of the things you guys, some of you guys are newer, so let me just tell you what we do. We tape our services each week. Now, every once in a while, there's a hiccup with technology. There's a hiccup with videoing the disc. There's always a hiccup somewhere. But last week and the week before, I got to hear Brother David's sermon. Brother David Williford did an amazing job. That was phenomenal 2 weeks ago. Brother Neil did too. And I'm going to tell you, you guys missed the association meeting. He really, he let it out, association meeting. Boy, if you would, he let his hair down. He gave us a little talking to. It was really good. But I'm really excited to be able to continue our study in Romans. I'm very thankful for our guests for being able to come and speak. And, you know, sometimes as a pastor, I have to be gone. And sometimes it's really good to have a guest speaker. It lets you know how wonderfully and blessed you have to have your pastor here. No, I'm kidding. But it's a blessing to have these guys. They have done such a great job. I love them. I know Brother, matter of fact, I'm having breakfast tomorrow, or lunch with Brother David tomorrow. So we're going to spend a little time together with him tomorrow, a couple of pastors in the area. So we're excited about that. And of course, he's now leaving Florida, I think this week, and heading back to Tennessee. So, but if you have your Bibles, you're welcome to turn to Book of Romans. Book of Romans, we're kicking in chapter 6. Chapter 6. Thank you so much. I almost asked you to go do that. You're amazing. You never know when they're going to drive by faster than 35 and you hear it more than anything else, right? So today we have just a two-point outline. I know it can't be done, but hopefully we can get it done. We'll see. So the introduction is this. Chapter 6 through chapter 8, Paul continues to explain in detail what it's like to have a right standing with God. What's the big church word for that? Anybody remember? Justification. Being justified. So a right standing with God means we're just as if we have never sinned, okay? That's justification. As a matter of fact, Paul goes on to tell us followers of Christ how we should live differently with the relationship of sin now that we're followers of Christ. Those who follow Christ by faith have a different relationship with sin and the power of sin. Dr. Robert Piccirilli says it this way, that we should lead a victorious Christian living, or should live, our relationship with sin is different, so therefore we should be living a victorious Christian life. Over the years in my ministry, and I think this happened more in my younger years, I was pretty argumentative in my late teens, early 20s. You know anybody else like that? Don't point fingers, moms and dads. Okay. Were you like that? Okay. Are some of you still like that? I'm not looking. No. Some of us are still pretty. We know what we believe, and we're going to believe it. Now listen, here's. I picked this up from one of my lay guys in my last church. I have every right to change my mind on theology, particularly if you can show me in Scripture. Is that fair? We can agree to disagree at times. Gary and I love Brother Gary to death, and I'll pick at him since he's not here, but we don't always see eye to eye, and that's okay. But about 95, 98% of the time, on the primaries, about 99%, we're on top of it. Some of the secondaries, 98. Tertiaries, about 40. I used to say 70, but more we talk, it was like 40. It's okay. We're going to agree to disagree sometime. And I say this sarcastically for those of you who have that as your gift. You have every right to be wrong. I'm kidding. I am kidding. I can't do sarcasm. I always apologize for doing it. I just can't do it. But in my early walk with the Lord, and particularly as a younger preacher, I kept running across people. And as I talked with them, they almost lived out this philosophy of having a license to sin. Now, some of you may know what I'm talking about here. So let me give you an illustration this way. Back in the 1900s, particularly in the early 80s, now you young people, this is going to be so good. You got to listen to this. This is really cool. In the early 80s, my dad, my brother, and I, well, we would watch a lot of TV movies. Now, let me explain what TV movies were back in the 80s. They were things you saw at the cinema, okay? But, not like today, they're not the exact same. Number one, they had to be cut down from widescreen to a shorter screen, so it was kind of like a zoomed-in area. And, are you ready? There was no bad words in the movies. I mean, matter of fact, it wasn't just bleeped out. You would have a different guy say a different word. Didn't he sound like the actor at times? I mean, it was just weird, which is fine. I'm glad. Matter of fact, I want more of that in my life. I look at some TV shows that are out there. Now that looks pretty cool. And next thing you know, there's an F-bomb. I'm like, okay, I won't be watching that one. You know, I mean, there's some guy shows I think our world we're making. I think us guys go, oh, I want to see that. Then the language is terrible. And I'm like, okay, let's don't go there. Or there's other things when I do reviews. I'm like, oh, yeah, I don't need to see that. Don't need that in my head. But there was a show, a movie, again, early 80s particularly, and now I'm saying early 80s, like 82, 83, 84, maybe 81. This one particular person, when he introduced himself, he says, my name is Bond, James Bond. I love that. That was awesome, right? And he was always dressed to a T, usually, in a very nice outfit, usually a tux. But there was something he carried that was very unique. He had a very unique license. I know we got some kids in here, but I think most of us old enough. He had a license to kill. So, first question today is, do Christians have a license to sin? That's our first point. That's what we're going to deal with. Point two is joining Christ. So, point one, do Christians have a license to sin. Now, Romans chapter 6, verse 1 says this. Well, then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more wonderful grace? Now, the words keep on sinning, in some translations says continue. But yes, this is one of those wonderful continuous action verbs. Okay? I love how Mr. Fourlines shared this, and he said it gives more, in the Greek, it gives more just the idea of continuing. For instance, I have a couple of people in my life, I use this term a lot, they're very persistent, and I smile really big. Anybody know what I'm really trying to say? They're stubborn as a mule. Got any persistent people in your life? Don't elbow them. But we all have some people who are persistent. They're stubborn. I did it my way. You know, have I showed you guys a story about a 40-something-year-old that he lived this way and he was going to die this way? Have I ever did that? Oh, I have. Some of you have heard it. Who hadn't heard it? Raise your hand if you never heard the story. Okay, one person, two people, three people. Okay, here we go. So I had the opportunity to win this lady in her 40s to the Lord. I was in my mid-20s. Winnie and I were pastoring in Southern California. I won't give a lot of information away because, anyway, she is now with the Lord. She has now passed away. And she had a husband. She had tried to win the Lord, and he just didn't want to have it. He was fighting for cancer, and we prayed over him, and he finally got, you know, results are good. Life goes on. Things going well. He's remission. Life's good. His son comes home off a trip. He comes in. Dad can't sleep. Dad goes, gets him a cigarette, gets him a beer. He sits down in his lazy boy and said, Dad, man, you just won over cancer. What are you doing? He said, I've lived this way and I'll die. And in eternity he went, 45 years old. And why do I say that? There's some people, they're persistent. And what Mr. Fourline says in the Greek here, it's not that they keep on sinning. They are persistent to keep on sinning. I mean, they're stubbornly doing it. Does this make sense, everybody? So then, Paul says, and again, Paul is trying to answer, it's amazing how God used this, but Paul's kind of answering some of your thinking, and your question is, well then, should we just keep on sinning persistently? Should we just keep on sinning and sinning and sinning more? Like we have a license to sin? This is exciting. I just keep on doing it because more grace is going to come. It's wonderful. But Paul says in his first part of verse 2, of course not! Or in the King James, God forbid. I heard just recently a Jewish conservative speaker. Now, he's a non-Messianic Jew. Let me explain the difference. A Messianic Jew is someone who is truly of the Jewish descent, as in race, or not race, ethnicity, bloodline, who actually follow Christ as the Lord and Savior. So this man is a non-Messianic Jew. He's a Jewish man. He's a very conservative, political man. And he does not believe in Jesus as we as followers of Christ would believe in Jesus. He said a few weeks ago about his belief as a Jew. Like so many of Paul's days, he believes he must try to achieve righteousness by keeping and observing the law and have really good works. If you remember a few weeks back, Paul said it cannot be done because the law was never given as a means or a way to salvation, so no one can live the law perfectly. So the logic of this Jewish conservative, and quite frankly the Jews of Paul's days, which was, I must do my best to live out the law and try really, really hard to do good works so that God will allow me to earn my way into heaven. I hope I'm good enough. Hope I'm good enough. He's a righteous judge. I hope I am good enough to get there. Of course, this type of logic is wrong. But it's also wrong to have the logic to think, well, if I can't work my way to heaven, I can't really fulfill the law perfectly because I can't. And I just learned, Paul, from chapter 5, that where sin abounds, grace overflows even more. So, why should I even worry about it? Let's sin and sin big time. Let's do this. Because the more I sin, the more grace I get. Anybody see the fallacy there in that logic? Question two. Our point two. Joining Christ. Now, we had a lot to read here. We're going to start in chapter 6, verse 2, and just keep going. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Last week, about a week and a half now, I was walking, I had my brand new shoes from China, and I'm enjoying them. I love the shoes. They're pretty cool. They're not quite, they're meant like a tennis shoe, so they're really flexible, but they have like no arch support. That's the only thing I don't like about them. They're called Gatsby's. But anyway, they're really cool. They look good. They feel good. They're super light. Just not enough arch support. I guess I might have to get some soles or something to add to it, you know, insoles or something. But the other day I was walking here on the church property and something happened. I tripped over the lip of my shoe. You see this little lip? Oh gosh, I can't do that. See this little lip? I tripped over that. Does anybody have that kind of power? That superpower? We used to call our kids grace, certain ones more than others. They were so gracious, they would just fall over air. I tripped over the lip of my shoe. Do you know what else happened? It tore my shoe. Zoe says, well, we'll get some hot glue for that one. My new shoes. I mean, I've only worn them like 3 times. I don't know if I will buy any more. I'm just saying. How much you want to bet? Let's see if I can slap it down. Oh, we're not bidding over time yet. Yay, we did it. So just walking, I tripped over the lip of the shoe. Now, I've got to admit, I asked Wendy to read over that because sometimes my wording is not very good, especially my grammar. For those who are grammar Nazis, I apologize. God called me. He knew what he was doing. I still wonder sometimes, but I do my best. But she said, I don't think it's called a lip of a shoe. It's the toe. And so what I think my wife forgot, I actually have a degree from Shoe University. You laugh. I literally do. I used to sell ladies' shoes at what anchor store? Anybody remember? Dillard's. And at Dillard's, you have to go through Shoe University. Literally, you have to get a degree in Shoe University. It wasn't 4 years. It was more like 14 hours. But I did really well. I was the second highest commission salesman there was. Out of four. I will have to tell the story one day, not right now. But needless to say, I tripped. I was discouraged because I tripped. I was more discouraged because I just spent X amount of dollars on these shoes from China. And it bugged me that they're already ripped and torn. I'm thinking these things are cheap. You get what you pay for, some people say, right? But please understand something. Why am I telling the story? Because Jesus told stories. He told parables. But it's also real life. It's actually what happened. And in life, you and I, sometimes we trip. We slip up. Sometimes we get aggravated. Sometimes we get discouraged. Sometimes we say or think things we shouldn't think or say. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Because the kids around you are hearing it all. But more importantly, God is listening to everything you say, right? Now, there's a difference from slipping and tripping over your lip. Some of us trip over the lip of our shoes. Some of us trip over these lips. We get negative. We get angry with God. We blame God. We question him. We get angry with people, particularly our family. Because you guys are, we're all amazing around other people. I told somebody the other day, I said, I have learned in my 30-something years of pastoring and ministry, but just being a human being at 50, most kids are much better for other people than they are their own family. And he's like, well, mine shouldn't be. We train them right. I'm thinking, yeah, I train mine right too. But when I'm not there, I hope they're doing right. Because I've taught them, I hope they're doing right. And yeah, they still may get in trouble if they don't, if I find out later. And we live in a small town. I mean, aren't you folks in your 80s and 70s and 60s so glad they didn't have these when you were teenagers, videoing everything you did wrong and then send it to your parents because they were watching? Hey, I'm going to send this to your mom and dad. It's crazy how many people send my wife and I pictures just every once in a while. It's crazy. And I wonder, I'm like, I wonder if they told my kids they sent me that. And just FYI, we haven't always done this, but one particular is kind of fun. I get every text they get. There's apps now. You can see every text message your children get. Every single thing. I love it. Parents, you should do that. Kids, if you don't like what I have to say, I love you. You need help. And if that means mom and dad seeing everything you see to help you, they're trying to help you and protect you. I think it's a good idea. Grandparents, it's a good idea. Well, my kids can't afford that for my grandkids. Eat one less a week and help your kids pay for that, and then you see what's going on in text. Well, grandma sees everything I say. You guys got to watch what you see. My grandma hearing this, and I'm her favorite. I can't mess this up. Hello? Hello? I can't mess this up. I'm her favorite. It's amazing what accountability can do to people. Now, why am I saying this? In life, sometimes we trip. Sometimes we trip over the lip. Sometimes we trip. There's a difference from those who trip and sin compared to those who are persistently training to sin. Everybody got me? Who keep on continuous actually straining to sin more. All right. There's a difference between walking and tripping and then walking, skipping, and running towards sin. Being persistent. Can you see the difference? Can you guys see the difference? There's a difference between saying I walk with God, but I run full blast towards sin. So I believe there's a few questions that we need to answer. So here we go. If you're taking notes, great time to take them. If you haven't, it's a good time. You can use your bulletin. They're there. You can put it in your smart device. It's great. And I would love for you guys to go through these and spend an extra deeper thought with them, okay? Question A. That should be believers. Okay, so I sent you the wrong one, but that's okay. We updated it, but I guess I didn't save it correctly. As believers, add your R in there. I apologize. Spell check doesn't get that. You guys get that, right? Spell check. It is spelled correctly. It's just the wrong word. As believers, do we sin? I see a lot of you shaking your heads. All right, so follow along quickly. Think carefully. Listen carefully to the scripture. 1 John 1:5. This is the Apostle John. This is the beloved. Okay? This is the one to whom Jesus said, "Woman, this is your son. Son, this is your mother." In other words, John, I need you to take care of my mom because I'm on the cross and my time's up. Okay? He was the beloved. This is what he says. "This message we heard from Jesus and now declare to you." I love his eyewitness testimony. Now, here we go. He says this. "God is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. So we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness." I want you to think of that persistently sinning. That living in persistent sin. Everybody have with me? If so, say yes. Okay? Living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth, verse 7. "But if we are living in the light," sometimes we trip, sometimes we slip up. "As God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from what? All sin." Let's go on, verse 8. "If we claim we have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth." One of my favorite verses. "But if we confess our sins to him," hallelujah, "he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all the wickedness." Verse 10 says, "If we claim we have not sinned, we're calling God a liar and showing that his word has no place in our heart." Now, it goes on to chapter 2. Now, this is all one full thought. Chapter 2 of 1 John, "My dear children, I'm writing this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, if you trip, we have an advocate who pleads our case before the Father. He is Jesus Christ, the one who is truly righteous. So let's go back to the very first point, and don't jump back there, but just, well, actually, if you would, jump back there. Verse number one. So the question I asked was, number one, not A, one. Do Christians have a license to sin according to Scripture? Nor do we have a license to kill, right? We don't have a license to kill, nor do we have a license to sin. Because we're not supposed to be being persistent, super stubborn in a sinful life. If we're doing that, number one, I question, are you really saved? You may not know Jesus as Lord and Savior, and we want you saved. Jesus wants you saved. He gave his lifeblood for you to be saved. Now, at the same time, but Pastor, there's been times in my life I just keep falling down over the same thing. Cool, I get it. Me too. And God put some godly men, an amazing wife, and some other people around me to help support me. Got some good counseling, spent thousands of dollars, Christ-centered counseling, thousands, okay? Marital counseling. Every person on the planet needs counseling. I don't need it. Pride comes before the fall. And I say good Christian counseling, God-centered counseling. We all need it. Why? Because we are imperfect people, coming from imperfect people, surrounded by imperfect people. And sin has impacted us. Sometimes we just need to talk to somebody who thinks outside of us. And then no offense to your mom and daddy, your grandma, grandpa, and your kids. Sometimes you need to talk to somebody who's not your family. Because sometimes family can be biased either for you or biased against you. Am I right? Sometimes family is biased for you, and sometimes they're biased against you. So sometimes you just need somebody to talk to that's Christ-centered that you can work through some issues. And I'm telling you, God can give you the power, according to Scripture, to overcome that thing you keep slipping on and falling on. Matter of fact, I still remember this one guy. We're in Bible college together. He's like, you know, I used to be a drug addict. I was a womanizer. He talked about all this stuff. If I named some of the bars that he went to, many of us in this room probably either been there in our old sinful lives or you know exactly what I'm talking about because it was in the Tri-State area. It was in the Tri-State area. And he was a young preacher. He was older than I was in college, but he had answered call to preach. He said, man, I'm telling you, God, he said, I was delivered from drugs the moment I accepted Christ. He said, I never even had withdrawals. He said, never wanted alcohol ever again. Matter of fact, it just smells like horse urine. It just smells bad now. I used to love to taste that stuff. He said, I got saved and it's just gone. He said, but there's one thing I struggle with so much. Now, you guys are going to love this because I was the same way. He said, I can't stop cussing to save my life. Can you imagine a preacher to cuss? He was saved by the grace of Jesus, never wanted drugs again, never wanted alcohol again, never slept around again until he got married. I mean, he said, I never went through withdrawals. He said, but my mouth, I struggle with language like you wouldn't believe. Is that crazy? Now, some of us may not struggle there, but we may struggle with something else. Everybody with me? And some sins just more socially acceptable. I mean, I used to pick at preachers, and I'm becoming one. I mean, they would call this out and call this out. I'm like, dude, you're 150 pounds overweight, and you're calling out that? I mean, I know that's not your preference, but I don't know if I would call that sin. But you're 150 overweight. I call that sin. And I don't think you're trying. I mean, I didn't know him that well, but anybody know what I'm talking about? I know I'm there. I'm getting there. I'm not 150 overweight, but my BMI is not what it needs to be. And I'm struggling. Amen. Anybody struggle with me? You struggle? Who's on the struggle bus with me? Yeah, there's times I hate telling my belly no, or my wants and my eyes and my taste buds. There's times I just want my palate to taste it one more time. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Okay. Now, according to these verses, yes, we sin. But we should not make it a persistent practice of sinning. Everybody with me? To say we do not sin makes us a liar. So the next question of A, do believers sin? Yes, sometimes we do. Sometimes it's every day. Sometimes it's a brand new one every day. And it may be something, you may be free from this, but you're struggling with this one. And here's the thing, what I've learned in my short-lived life. Some of the things you struggle with, I don't, and then vice versa. I still remember, I don't want to go into too much information, but anyway. I was introduced one day, my counselor wanted me to go meet somebody else who had been coming and overcoming his issues. He was overcoming them and had been free for a long time. But he was a cross-dresser. I'll be honest with you, I struggle with that. I don't have that issue. I'm not like you. That was the first thing that went through my mind. Sorry, that was the first thing that went through my judgmental mind. I'm not like you. I have issues, but not like that. Folks, we all struggle with something. Some are just more socially acceptable than others. And I'm here to tell you, if you will put forth the work, I'll work with you. The problem is, when we don't want, well, if I open up, people hate me. Listen, I've said it 100 times, I'll say it 100 more. Everyone that walks in here brings what? Blessings and baggage. I have the most. I know because I know me. If you're willing to confess, God will forgive. And then sometimes we got to retrain this thing right here. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. You don't believe me? Read the scripture. We are to be renewed by transforming ourselves. How? By renewing of the mind. We change by changing our mind, the way we think about things. I used to do this, and I'm leaving my sermon a little bit here. I used to give this illustration. If you believe smoking's no big deal, it's cool and exciting, you have short-term results. Oh, this is so cool. Third one, short-term results. Immediately, you probably started coughing. Short-term results for a couple of weeks. Do you smell like smoke? What's the long-term? What are the potential long-term effects of 10, 20, 30, or 40 years? Lung cancer. Tobacco use, guys, I love you. That's a lot in the South. I can't tell you how many guys I've known have gum, not just gum disease, but in time getting gum cancer because of tobacco. Now, I've seen more just lose their teeth because of tobacco. And you single girls, I love you, but if they chew tobacco, I wouldn't even go out with them. Would you want to kiss somebody who, no offense, ladies, you married people, would you want to kiss somebody? I mean, my grandma chewed snuff, and she would kiss us. Grandma, she loved Jesus. I mean, she had her Bible on her lap all the time, and she can quote scripture left and right, but, oh, that snuff kiss was just, I'm not just picking on that, but same thing happens with other things. But what if I was taught, hey, smoking long term could hurt me? It's not as cool as people say it. And the first time I tried it, like 5 and 6 years old, I was stupid. We stole it from our neighbor's house. And yeah, I did. Oh, yeah. I've smoked at least 3 in my life. I was 5 or 6, something like that. I coughed for days. Anybody remember the red cap guns? You shoot them, had a little red, and they would smoke up. That's what I told my mom and dad. I kept blowing it off, and I sucked in too much of that smoke, Mom, Dad. I lied through my teeth. I confess. I don't think I ever told them that. They don't watch YouTube. It's good. They won't see it. But anyway, actually, Dad does if it's Christmas. But anyway, why am I saying all that? What if I was taught, hey, smoking's bad for you, it can hurt you? You're not going to want to smell like smoke. Maybe my thinking would have been differently. Does that make sense? Maybe I would never tried it. But the cool guys I was hanging out with who were 2 and 3 and 4 years older than me thought it was so cool. And they helped us steal the cigarettes because we were too short to reach it. Because it was on top of the fireplace. What do you call that? The hearth. Mantle. There you go. What did I say? Hearth? 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 Tomato, tomato, Missouri, Missouri. Yeah. I can't say things right. Believers. Okay. So, do believers sin? Yes. Should we be persistently living in sin? If we are, what should we really question? Are we really right with Jesus? guys, I'm not trying to scare you. And, oh, you're going to make me scared of my salvation. No, I don't want you to die in burning hell. Because if you think you're saved but you're walking in darkness, you're lying to yourself. And the father of all lies is Satan. Everybody with me? I'm just being very blunt and truthful. Now, we're going to sin. We shouldn't make it a persistent habit of it, but sometimes we sin. And some of you, if you'll just be vulnerable and get help, I'm telling you, by the hand of God and the power of God, you won't be struggling with that forever. But some of us believe the lie, well, I'm going to always struggle with this. I'm just going to have to always deal with it. No, you don't. That's a lie straight from the gates of hell. He's got a hook in you, and he's just trying to pull you on further back with his hook. You guys get what I'm saying? All right. Question B. Do I have time? I think I do. Hopefully I do. How you guys doing? We okay? Hold on. How many slides I got? I can't do that in 5 minutes. Okay. Next week, hey, I got that one right. Believers. Next week, we'll start B. All right, so let's review. According to Scripture, do Christians have a license of sin? No. I'm going to be harsh right now. Then stop living like you think you do. As a teenager living in sin, I looked at my girlfriend and said, hey, we're Christians. We can ask God to forgive us later when we're done. Who would have hated for your daughter to date somebody like me? That was my thinking. I bought into this. We're forgiven. It's okay. I can do what I want. He's already forgave me. Guys, that's a lie straight from the gates of hell. And we'll talk more about that. But that was my thinking then. It was wrong. It was wrong logic. It was wrong thinking. It was not God honoring. It was all about what John wanted. Hello? It was all what I wanted. So if Christians do not have a license to sin, then you and I must quit living like we have a license to sin. Then the question is, do believers sin? Yes, we do. Sometimes we trip over our lips, over our thought life. Sometimes we go places on our devices that we shouldn't go. I was talking to a young man just recently. It's nobody here. Don't try to figure it out who it is. But I've been talking to a young man recently. I said, hey, listen, take your phone and give it to your parents when you go to bed. Why would I do that? Because you won't be tempted so much. But what that means, I got to tell them. Tell them. I'll tell them with you. If you're close enough, I'll say, come bring it to me. I'll keep your phone until the next morning. I had a gentleman look at me one time when we went from 60,000 to 18 months. I went and got financial counseling. I did. I was like, I need help. We're about to lose everything. We went through a downsize and a right sizing. I mean, I just lost 400 a week. I'm going to lose more, I think. And we did. I was like, I can't pay all the bills. What do I need to do? He said, how much cash you got? I said, I got about, I don't know, it was like maybe 1,500 at the time. He said, do I need to hold that for you? So what do you mean? He said, well, John, I think you've been spending more than you've been making for a while. True, I was. And my guess is you're going to think it's an emergency, and it's not really an emergency. You're going to see a really good deal. And you're going to think, I have some cash, I can pay for it. So do I need to hold that money for you? Because he was a 40-minute drive away. I would literally have to go do that. So fast forward, that was 06. So in 09, when we moved to Missouri, I still had about $1,500 for emergency fund, okay, at the time. I opened in a credit union, you're going to love this, 1.5 hour away credit union. I opened it up, I put it there. So would you like checks? Nope. You want a debit card? Nope. If it's hard enough, I will drive here and get it out. Why? Because I had to retrain myself. If it's really an emergency, I can drive an hour and a half Monday through Friday to go get it. One way. It'd be a 3-hour round trip. If it was a really emergency, not it was on sale, or, ooh, this would be really nice. I can buy it early, reimburse it later. You know, our government doing that for years. I owe you to the Social Security system. Let's just don't even go there. You know what I'm saying? Some of us do that in our homes. Well, we'll take our emergency fund. We owe you it later, but we never pay it back. Can we find another great deal? Does this make sense? And why am I saying that? For that young man, I said, give your phone to your parents. My mentor said, hey, do you need to give me that $1,500 so you won't spend it? Somebody like, well, how are you? I can't believe you have that low self-control. You didn't know me in 2009. Some of you were here when I tried out. I mean, but you didn't know me in 06. We only had two kids and went on the way. I mean, life was crazy. We lost everything. I cashed in my retirement. You know what penalties I paid? And the taxes? But I wanted to put food on the table. That was a good thing, right? It was. But why am I saying this? I had to change my thinking. The young man who keeps his phone at night and gets in trouble with his phone at night, he needs to change his thinking. To do that, he's got to change his habits. And for him, it means, hey, Mom, Dad, will you guys keep my phone and charge it for me tonight? Don't lie to your parents, but tell them you need them to charge it. Great. Why? You just won't be tempted. Don't go there. If yours is alcohol, don't go buy water bottles at Walmart, because that's where the alcohol is. I'll go get you water bottles. I still have my kids. Well, I don't pick them up anymore. They're too heavy. You guys what I'm saying? You spend too much? Cut up the credit cards. Whatever you're eating too much, have your wife or your husband or your best friend say, hey, how's your diet going? What diet? Are you eating healthier? Are you cutting back some carbs? So how many glasses of sugar did you drink today? Yeah, I get sick of hearing it too. Now, maybe it's that once a week you get on the scales and go, ah, I did better than that. I know I did. I guess I didn't, because accountability says I didn't. Sometimes we just need to come around to each other. Sometimes we just need somebody to walk alongside of us. As Christians, that's the Holy Spirit. And as Christians, that's the family of God. But Pastor, if I told you what I struggle with, you wouldn't love me anymore. That's a lie straight from the gates of hell. I've heard it all. Really. Child molester. I prayed with a child molester. And that really did mess me up. It was cool to hear him confess this. Actually, it wasn't cool. It was disgusting. I did not want to hear him confess. He confessed out loud. I'm like, dude, you don't have to pray this out loud. But he was getting things right with God. And I've had others like, would you like to accept Christ? Yeah, why don't you pray for me? I'm like, it don't work that way. I can pray all day to get saved, but you've got to accept Christ. I can't accept him for you. You have to do it. But I want to pray out loud. There's something in Scripture that says, believe in the heart and confess with the mouth. Romans. We're going to hit that here in a few weeks. Well, a couple months maybe. Okay? Does Christians sin? Yes. It should not be a persistent, habitual habit. If you're struggling with something, you want to talk about it, give me a yell. Give me a call. Let's sit down. If you're a lady, my wife and I sit down with you. But love to talk with you. Get help. If I can't help you, I'll refer somebody can. There's some great, actually, we have several great Free Will Baptist Christian counselors throughout the country. And the way Zoom and stuff works nowadays, you can talk to people in Africa on one of these things, you know, if they have the technology, or France, you know. Matter of fact, I talked to one of our missionaries a couple weeks ago on one of these things. It was kind of cool. You know, just see how he's doing. I love you guys. I want to challenge you, if you never accepted Christ, Lord and Savior, today's a good day. We all have hurts, habits, and hang-ups. Don't wallow in sin. Repent. Christ will not reject you. If you confess it, he will forgive you. But you've got to confess it. You've got to repent. Let's pray. Father, you're so good. Lord, you're better than we can even imagine. Father, you do give grace upon grace. Lord, help us not to be liars and say, we're living in the truth, we're living in light, but we're actually walking and running in darkness. Father, help us support our brothers and sisters, Lord. Help us to be there with open ears and closed mouths to hear the struggle and talk with them. pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to move in hearts of people. There's someone in the sound of my voice who's never truly repented. I pray today when they repent of their sins and ask for forgiveness. Father, for the Christians who are struggling, I pray, God, help them to seek you for peace, forgiveness, for reassurance. Lord, work in moving and changing their heart and changing their mind.